Welcome to Daily News Simplified, an answer to what, why and how of newspaper reading.
Now today, we shall be analyzing about the Hindu newspaper dated 28 January 2019. The news to be discussed has been presented on the screen and timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. Now let's start our today's discussion. Now the first news appears as a lead article on page number 8. It says, removing the roots of farmers' distress, steps like limited procurement, boosting productivity and consolidating land holdings can help reduce agrarian distress. Now this article becomes extremely important because different questions have been asked by UPSC on issues relating to Indian agriculture. And as you know, the issue of agrarian distress or farm distress has been in news for quite some time. So on this note, this article becomes very important, and also because of the fact that it has been written by C. Rangarajan, who is a former chairman of the Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister. So on this note, his views on agrarian distress becomes extremely important and significant for the upcoming examination. This topic of agrarian distress in your preliminary examination forms a part of Indian economy, whereas in your mains, it gets covered under GS Paper 3. So as discussed, the authors in this article has focused on limited procurement, boosting productivity and consolidation of land holdings as key areas to increase farm income. So some of the components of agricultural distress can be low agricultural prices, low productivity in agriculture, supply side constraints and declining average size of land holdings. So it is based on these constraints that this article provides for possible solution for agricultural distress. So in this context, this article provides for possible solution for agricultural distress, and based on this, the article has been divided into prices and incomes, low productivity and land size. Let's go through these three different concepts as provided in this article separately. Now price plays a key role in affecting farmers' income, and even during the Green Revolution, along with technology and associated packages, price factor was considered extremely important. However, in the last 2 years, inflation in agriculture has been much lower as compared to overall inflation. The article has tried to highlight this fact through implicit price deflator. Now, implicit price deflator is a measure of inflation. It shows to what extent an increase in GVA, that is gross value addition, in an economy has taken place or happened on account of higher prices rather than on increased output. So on this note, let's go through some of the data as provided in this article. So the implicit price deflator for GVA for the period 2017-18 for total is 3.2%, whereas for agriculture is 1.1% only. So this shows that in the last 2 years, inflation in agriculture has been much lower as compared to overall inflation. Further, advanced estimates for 2018-19 for implicit deflator for GVA for agriculture is 0%, whereas for total is 4.8%. So we see that there is hardly any increase in prices of agricultural commodities, and this effectively has resulted in less farm income. Further, market prices for several agricultural commodities have been much lower than MSP, that is minimum support price. Now MSP is the price at which government purchases crops from the farmers. So MSP is basically a form of market intervention by the government to insure farmers against any fall in prices. Further, an increase in production of crops has also resulted in crashing of prices of agricultural commodities as production increases beyond market demand. This also impacts the farmers in absence of any price support policy by the government in such extreme situations. So the article for this particular purpose has suggested a limited procurement scheme. The authors have suggested this limited procurement scheme primarily to stabilize price, and this can be done when the government will procure the excess production which has taken place. So under this scheme, the authors have suggested that procurement will continue by the government till the market price increases to touch MSP, that is minimum support price. So basically, under this scheme, the idea is to remove excessive production from the market so that the price level which had crashed earlier comes back to the original price. Thus, there is a need to find a balance between MSP, limited procurement, and price stabilization. The cereals collected under this limited procurement scheme can be sold later by the government or used in welfare programs. However, the authors suggest that limited procurement scheme will not work if MSP is fixed at a level to which the market price will never rise. So, there needs to be a balance between market price as well as minimum support price. Thus, on this note, the author suggests that there needs to be a balance between minimum support price, limited procurement, and price stabilization in the market. So, the author suggests that raising MSP, income support schemes, and price deficient payments, that is the difference between market price and MSP, solves only the partial problem with respect to agrarian distress. So the authors have suggested that a sustainable solution is market reform to enable better price discovery combined with long-term trade policies favorable for exports. And to achieve this, there is a need for creation of a competitive, stable, and unified national market for farmers to get better prices for their farm products. On this note, the author highlights that agricultural markets have witnessed only limited reforms as they are characterized by inefficient physical operations, excessive crowding of intermediaries in the agricultural markets, and fragmented market chains. So all these effectively and in a combined way deprives farmers of their share of price. Further, even the states have not shown any urgency in reforming their markets. So the author argues that for farmers to attain better prices, agriculture has to go beyond farming, and there's a need to develop a value chain comprising farming, wholesaling, warehousing, logistics, processing, as well as retailing. So these are some of the issues highlighted by the author in Prices and Incomes. The next issue highlighted in this article is with respect to low productivity in Indian agriculture. And on this aspect, highlighting on the basics become extremely important, like seeds, fertilizers, land and water management, as well as use of technology. Further, investment in research and development is also extremely necessary. Water management and efficiency is also necessary in both canal and groundwater management. And this is because some crops needs more water than other crops, as more than 60% of irrigation water is consumed by rice as well as sugarcane. Hence, in this aspect, water management and efficiency for different crops becomes extremely important. Now, this article also highlights about lack of water management in India, as it uses up to 3 times the water used to produce 1 ton of grain as compared to countries such as Brazil, China, and US. So there is a need to use technology for proper water management and its efficient use. So this article mentions that several crops have low yield, and technology can help in increasing the yield of crops. And this will also help in improving productivity of crops. Crop yield refers to crops generated or produced from a unit of land. The article suggests that the government policies is more biased towards increasing productivity of rice and wheat. However, the government should shift its focus towards millets, pulses, fruits, vegetables, livestock, and even fish. The next topic highlighted by the article is with respect to land size. Another major issue highlighted by this article is with respect to shrinking of farm size, and this is leading to low income of farmers, thereby leading to farmers' distress. As you can see in these statistics, it says that the average land holdings in 1970-71 was 2.3 hectares, which has reduced to 1.08 hectares in 2015-16. Similarly, share of small and marginal farmers were 70% in 1980-81, which has increased to 86% in 2015-16. So this shows about land fragmentation taking place in the country. Another aspect highlighted in this article is that most of the farmers cannot leave agriculture and go to non-farm sector, as non-farm sector does not pay that much, and they can get only partial income from such non-farm sector. So in this context, also consolidation of land holdings becomes important to raise farmers' income. Thus, the article suggests that we need to have a proper government policies on land consolidation along with land developmental activities in order to tackle the challenge of land fragmentation. On this note, the article suggests that farmers can voluntarily come together and pool land to gain the benefits of size. And through this, farmers can yield benefit of a collective crop yield. So on a concluding note, the article says that farmers' distress is mainly due to low prices and low productivity. And suggestions as made by this article with respect to limited procurement, boosting productivity and consolidation of land holdings can help the farmers in reducing agrarian distress. However, the government must come up with a long-term and sustainable policy to reduce agrarian distress in the Indian economy. Hence, on this note, this article becomes extremely important from our examination perspective. Now, let us go through some of the questions asked in mains examination on various issues pertaining to Indian agriculture. As you can see, different questions on Indian agriculture have been asked by UPSC in 2018, 17, 16, and even 15. So, on this note, this topic becomes extremely important. Now, one thing which we should know is about the difference between marginal farmer and small farmer. It says that marginal farmer means a farmer cultivating agricultural land up to 1 hectare, and small farmer means a farmer cultivating agricultural land of more than 1 hectare but up to 2 hectares. So this is the difference between small farmer and marginal farmer. So let's see the questions asked by UPSC in different years. Now in 2018, the question was, how has the emphasis on certain crops brought about changes in cropping patterns in recent past? Elaborate the emphasis on millets production and consumption. In 2017, the question was, explain various types of revolutions which took place in agriculture after independence in India. How these revolutions have helped in poverty alleviation and food security. In 2016, the question was, discuss the role of land reforms in agricultural development. Identify the factors that were responsible for success of land reforms in India. In 2015, the question was, in view of declining average size of land holdings in India, which has made agriculture non-viable for a majority of farmers, should contract farming and land leasing be promoted in agriculture? Critically evaluate the pros and cons. So we see that various aspects with respect to land fragmentation, crop diversification, and even land reforms in agriculture has been asked by UPSC. So on this note, the issues highlighted in this article, specifically with respect to limited procurement, boosting productivity and consolidated land holdings, becomes very important from our exams perspective. So with this, let's move on to our next news analysis. The next news appears on page number 3. It says, Orissa government transfers funds to sharecroppers under new scheme. Now this news is with reference to Kalia scheme. However, in the previous article that we just discussed, there was a mention of Kalia scheme as well as Raithu Bandhu scheme. Now, Kalia scheme is basically a scheme of the government of Odisha, and Raithu Bandhu scheme belongs to the state government of Telangana. So, in this analysis, let us understand certain key points with respect to Kalia scheme as well as Raithu Bandhu scheme. Now, this topic in your prelims examination forms a part of economic and social development as well as in mains. It gets covered under GS paper 3 under issues of Indian economy. Now it says that Kalia stands for Krushak Assistance for Livelihood and Income Augmentation. Now this Kalia scheme of late has been in news for quite some time. So it's important to understand about this Kalia scheme. It says that the scheme was launched by the government of Odisha to accelerate agricultural prosperity and reduce poverty in the state. And it is in this aspect that we have just covered an article co-authored by C. Rangarajan sir. So the question is that who is eligible to get benefit under Kalia scheme? It says that the scheme is for the benefit of small and marginal farmers. As we have seen that small farmers refers to a farmer cultivating land of more than 1 hectare but up to 2 hectare. Whereas marginal farmers refers to farmers cultivating land up to 1 hectare. So this scheme is for the benefits of small and marginal farmers. It's also for the benefit of landless agricultural household, vulnerable agricultural household, landless agricultural laborers and sharecroppers. Now sharecropping is a form of agriculture in which land owner allows a tenant to use land for farming in return of share of crops produced on their portion of land. So on this note we can say that sharecroppers are the actual cultivators of land. Now under this Kalia scheme, marginal and small farmers are eligible to get financial assistance up to a tune of Rs. 25,000 per family and this can be availed over 5 seasons under support to cultivators for cultivation. Further, even landless agricultural households are eligible for financial assistance up to a tune of Rs. 12,500 for the livelihood support under the scheme. Further, the Kalia scheme also covers vulnerable agricultural household, and it covers vulnerable cultivators as well as landless agricultural laborers. And both of them are eligible to get financial assistance up to Rs. 10,000 per year under this Kalia scheme. So basically, the state government of Orissa provides financial assistance to small and marginal farmers, landless agricultural households, as well as vulnerable agricultural households covering vulnerable cultivators and landless agricultural laborers. Now, it says that vulnerable cultivators and landless agricultural laborers include old age, disability, disease, or any other reason which makes them vulnerable cultivators or landless agricultural laborers. Further, the Kalia schemes also provides for life insurance support and interest-free crop loans for all categories of beneficiaries as mentioned above under this Kalia scheme. Now, apart from supporting small and marginal farmers, landless agricultural households and vulnerable agricultural household, Kalia scheme also provides support to cultivators for cultivation, livelihood support for landless agricultural household, and it provides financial assistance to vulnerable agricultural household. However, in this, one beneficiary will avail only one benefit as per the eligibility norms under the Kalia scheme. And as mentioned, that this Kalia scheme also provides for life insurance support and interest-free crop loans for all categories of beneficiaries under this particular scheme. So we understand that it becomes important to understand different components of this Kalia scheme. Now, moving further, let us also understand about Raitu Bandhu scheme by Government of Telangana, as this was also mentioned in the article co-authored by C. Rangarajan sir. It says that Raitu Bandhu scheme, also known as Farmers Investment Support Scheme, and this scheme has been introduced in order to support farmers' investment in the agriculture so as to boost agricultural prosperity. Under the scheme, the government is providing Rs. 4000 per acre per season twice a year for growing Kharif and Rabi crops. It says that this financial assistance is provided to all the farmers and there is no cap on the number of acres owned by the farmers. So basically, there is no cap with respect to marginal or small farmers, and financial assistance is provided to all farmers under this Raitu Bandhu scheme. Now, another important aspect of this Raitu Bandhu scheme is also with respect to the distribution of agricultural land in the state of Telangana. It says that more than 75% of agricultural land in Telangana is under the control of small and marginal farmers, and hence this scheme is considered to be of immense benefit to these small and marginal farmers. However, this Raitu Bandhu scheme does not provide any assistance to the sharecroppers. So on this note, let us see a comparative analysis between Raitu Bandhu scheme and Kalia scheme. As you can see, the Kalia scheme is of state government of Odisha, whereas Raitu Bandhu scheme is of state government of Telangana. Now, the Kalia scheme covers small and marginal farmers, landless agricultural household, vulnerable agricultural household, landless agricultural laborers, and sharecroppers. Whereas Raitu Bandhu scheme covers all farmers without any discrimination. Kalia scheme covers tenants and sharecroppers, whereas Raitu Bandhu scheme do not cover these sharecroppers. Under this, financial assistance differs for different categories of beneficiaries, whereas under Raitu Bandhu scheme, there is a uniform financial assistance of Rs. 8,000 per year. Kalia scheme also provides for life insurance support, whereas this is not provided by Raitu Bandhu scheme. So this gives a comparative analysis between Kalia scheme and Raitu Bandhu scheme. And this comparison becomes extremely important from your prelims perspective in the upcoming 2019 examination. Now, after our discussion, this forms your practice questions for the day. What you can do is to take a pause of 5 seconds. Question number 1 says, consider the following statements. Kalia scheme has been launched by state of Telangana to increase agricultural prosperity. No, the statement is incorrect, as Kalia scheme has been launched by state government of Odisha. Second, Kalia scheme does not cover sharecroppers. As you can see, Kalia scheme covers sharecroppers. So So this statement is also incorrect. Third, Kalia scheme provides uniform financial assistance to different kinds of farmers. No, this statement is again incorrect. As you can see, Kalia scheme provides different financial assistance to different categories of beneficiary, whereas Raito Bandhu scheme, on the other hand, provides a uniform financial assistance to farmers. So in the first question, all the statements given above are incorrect. Hence, in this, D becomes our correct answer. Now, moving on to question number 2, it says, consider the following statements on Raito Bandhu scheme. First, it is a scheme by the central government to reduce agrarian distress. No, this is a scheme by the state government of Telangana, not by the central government. Second, it provides uniform financial assistance to all farmers. Yes, we have just seen. Third, it provides financial assistance to sharecroppers. As you can see, under the Raito Bandhu scheme, it does not provide financial assistance to sharecroppers. Hence, in this aspect, this also becomes incorrect. So in this, B becomes a correct answer, that is 2 only. So we see these kind of questions can be framed in your upcoming prelims examination based on these different kind of schemes. So on this note, you should go through both these schemes very carefully. With this, let's move on to our next news analysis. The next news appears on page number 13. It says, Kelkar moots setting up of Niti Aayog 2, allow it to handle structural issues. Now in this particular news, former Finance Commission Chairman Vijay Kelkar has pitched for setting up of a new Niti Aayog, to which he has referred it as Niti Aayog 2, and has proposed giving it responsibility for allocating capital and revenue grants to the states. And this he has suggested in his research paper titled Towards India's New Fiscal Federalism. So effectively, Vijay Kelkar has proposed to create a new Niti Aayog having financial powers to allocate resources to states. Vijay Kelkar in his paper suggests that there is a need to create a new or a distinct Niti Aayog which has financial powers to allocate resources to states, as it will help in making the new Niti Aayog a functionally distinct entity, and it will also help in removing regional imbalances in the economy of different states. However, while mentioning these points, Vijay Kelkar mentioned in his paper that he was not suggesting that the new Niti Aayog should take the form of erstwhile planning commission with respect to discretionary grants. The paper suggests that replacing the planning commission with Niti Aayog has reduced government's policy outreach, as Niti Aayog does not enjoy any power with respect to financial devolution, which the erstwhile planning commission used to enjoy. Now, planning commission used to allocate discretionary grant under Article 282 of the Indian Constitution. So basically, Article 282 says that the union or the state may make any grants for any public purpose, and this purpose for which they can make grants may not be the one on which either parliament or state legislature may make laws. So it effectively provided for discretionary grant to the government for any public purpose. So earlier, the erstwhile planning commission used to make discretionary grants under Article 282 of the Indian Constitution. However, as per Vijay Kelkar, the new Niti Aayog must address structural issues. And while addressing these structural issues, the new Niti Aayog must be responsible for allocating development or transformational revenue and capital grants. So this is what the new research papers has suggested on the functionings and role of the new Niti Aayog, which is referred to as the Niti Aayog 2. In order to make this new Niti Aayog 2 more successful, the research paper has suggested that vice chairman of this Niti Aayog 2 will need to be a permanent invitee of the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs. Now, all these suggestions are with respect to the regional imbalances as witnessed in different states, and also because of protest by various states which came after the recommendation of 15th Finance Commission. So on this note, it becomes interesting to observe this suggestion as mooted by the former Finance Commission Chairman Vijay Kelkar, which suggests to provide financial powers to this new Niti Aayog. Now this topic becomes a part of GS paper 2 in your mains examination, and in your prelims forms a part of Indian polity. Now we have just seen the news on new Niti Aayog 2, where the former Finance Commission Chairman Vijay Kelkar suggested to provide the new Niti Aayog 2 with certain financial powers so that they can allocate certain grants to states in order to reduce regional disparity. So based on that theme, you can look into this particular news coming on page number 14. It says state of play. It says that the gulf between rich states and poor states have widened in India in the past decade. So basically, there is a huge gap between the rich states and the poor states in the last decade. So it means in the last decade, that is in the last 10 years, the gap has widened. So basically, the richer states are getting more rich and poor states are getting more poor. And this can be seen through this particular data. It says that table shows the difference of state per capita income with national average. It says that states which started off in red, that is having a less per capita income than the national average in financial year 2008, remained so in financial year 2018. So basically, those states whose per capita income was below the national average continued to remain so even after 10 years. That is, even in 2018, those states' per capita income are below the national average. It then says that the per capita income of low-income states fell further below the All India averages, and it was vice versa for high-income states. So basically, it's saying that the high-income states or the rich states are getting richer, whereas the poor states are getting more poorer. And because of this, the gap between the rich states and the poor states are widening. And this is a growing concern with respect to economical disparity between states, or rather saying widening economical disparity between states. So it is on this aspect that even Vijay Kelkar has suggested for a new Niti Aayog, as the current Niti Aayog do not enjoy any financial power with respect to devolution of funds. So after going through this news, this particular news with respect to states inequality, where the rich states are getting more rich and where the poor states are getting more poorer, thereby widening the gulf between the rich and the poor state, becomes a major cause of concern. Now it says that in financial year 2008, 8 out of 17 states had per capita incomes lower than that of national average. And of these, only 4 grew faster than the All India rate. And these 4 states are Bihar, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Jharkhand. Among the 9 high income states which had higher per capita income than the national average in financial year 2008, 6 out of those 9 recorded a faster growth in the following 5 years. That is, from 2008 to 2013, 6 of those states witnessed a faster growth. So in this paragraph, we can also see the widening gulf between the rich and the poorer states. Now, another important aspect as highlighted here is that none of the low income states in financial year 2008 went on to become high income states by 2013. So this is again a very startling fact, that none of those low income states went on to become a high income states in the next 5 years from 2008 to 2013. Further, another cause of concern as highlighted is that out of those 8 low income states in financial year 2013, only 2 states, that is MP and Orissa, recorded marginally faster growth than the All India rate in the following 5 years. So this again shows, or this again highlights, the widening gulf of inequality between economic growth of states. So it says that the gap between high income and low income states widened further between fiscal years 2013 and 2018. So go through these diagrams with respect to growing inequality between different states of India. As it mentions that the richer states are getting more rich and poorer states are getting more poor. So it becomes a cause of concern, and the government must look forward to reduce this gap of inequality among states. Now the next article appears on page number 9. It says, Model for Malaria Control. Through its Daman initiative, Odisha has emerged as an inspiration in the global fight against malaria. Now this article is with respect to observations from World Health Organization World Malaria Report 2018. Now this topic in your mains examination forms a part of GS paper 2 under issues relating to health, and your prelims forms a part of general science. Now as per this World Malaria Report 2018, India is the only country among the 11 highest burden countries that saw substantial progress in reducing the disease burden. And as per the report, there has been a 24% decrease in 2017 as compared to 2016. So on this note, let us understand that how India achieved such a feat. So it mentions that in East Asia Summit in 2015, India pledged to eliminate the disease by 2030. And this pledging at East Asia Summit to eliminate the disease changed India's objective from curbing malaria to eliminating malaria. So basically, In the East Asia Summit of 2015, India pledged to eliminate the disease by 2030, and this changed India's objective from curbing malaria to completely eliminating malaria. And on this note, India has launched a 5-year national strategic plan for malaria elimination. And this strategic plan also provides a roadmap to achieve this target of ending or eliminating malaria in 571 districts out of 678 districts by the year 2022. However, despite these targets, there are still certain pressing concerns which remains. Now, one of the major concerns is that health is a state subject, and therefore it becomes imperative on the state government to shoulder maximum responsibility with respect to eradication of malaria. However, states at times face certain financial crunch, and they also lack from technical expertise that which is enjoyed by the central government. So there is a need for joint cooperation with other states and also involving the central government, as this joint cooperation among different states, including the central government, will further help in efficiently eliminating the malaria, and it will also help in completing the pledge taken at the East Asian Summit of 2015 to completely eradicate the disease by 2030. Now, as mentioned, this particular news also highlights about a program launched by the state government of Orissa, namely Daman. Now, Daman stands for Durgama Anchalare Malaria Nirakaran, and this is an initiative to prevent, diagnose and treat malaria. And one of the measures under Daman initiative is to spread DDT, that is dichlorodiphenyltrichloroethane. And this is also suggested by the World Health Organization to control the malaria vector by spreading DDT. So the measures under Daman initiative includes spreading of DDT, distribution of long-lasting insecticidal nets, which are medicated nets to be distributed among people infected with malaria, and also to provide proper health care to such people who are infected with malaria. And these initiatives has resulted in a 80% decline in cases of malaria, including deaths, from 2016 to 2017. So this article basically suggests that this initiative, which has started by the state government of Odisha, namely Daman, can be replicated by other states with specific changes based on local factors. So this article mentions that through Daman initiative, Orissa has emerged as an inspiration in the global fight against malaria, and this model can be replicated by other states where prevalence of cases of malaria are extreme. Thus, from a health perspective, this topic becomes extremely important. Now, after our discussion, these forms your practice question. What you can do is to take a pause of 5 seconds. Question number 3 says, which of the following are part of concurrent list under the 7th schedule of the Indian Constitution? Options are forest, education, economic and social planning. Now in this, all the three are part of concurrent list. Now forest is provided under entry 17A. Education is provided under entry 25. Whereas economic and social planning is provided under entry 20, provided on the concurrent list under the 7th schedule. So in this, 1, 2 and 3 is the correct answer. Now in this it says, Daman is an initiative for which of the following? We have already mentioned this is an initiative to eradicate malaria. So in this, B is a correct answer. So these type of questions can also be asked in your upcoming prelims examination. So on this note, this article becomes important both from your prelims as well as mains point of view.
With this, we come to an end to discussion of today's newspaper. Let's move on to the question for the day.